Thank you, everyone, for joining us today for this, the last in our fall into winter now series of Third Thursday Talks from the Vermont Historical Society. My name is Amanda Guthin. I'm the Public Program Manager here at the Vermont Historical Society. We're delighted to have all of you join us for this virtual talk with our speaker today, Jason Smiley. A couple of brief housekeeping notes. If you are not yet familiar with the website of the Vermont Historical Society, I strongly urge you to check it out, vermonthistory.org. We've got a lot of other great remote digital content coming up in the new year, trivia, cooking classes, home collections care classes, and more history talks from some really exciting scholars. So make sure you check out vermonthistory.org for everything that we have going on in the new year that you can join from the safety and comfort of your own home. And thank you for joining us today. This talk is being live streamed on Facebook as well as through the Zoom and will be recorded and available on the YouTube channel of the Vermont Historical Society after it is finished today. To those of you who are following along in the Zoom, please note that you will be able to ask questions using the Q&A function or using the chat function. I will keep an eye on both places and bring all questions to our speaker today at the end of his presentation. So feel free to type away while he's speaking, and I will get to you by reading them out loud when we finish today. That's all the housekeeping notes. I'm excited to get started. Jason, you can go over and ahead, switch over your screen whenever you're ready.
All right.
And I want to give you a brief introduction, which is that we're really thrilled to have you here today. Jason Smiley works at dealer.com during the day and appropriately enough at night researches the Eddy family of spirit mediums of Chittenden. He's been doing this research for quite some time and has spoken on it for other organizations. And we're thrilled to have him here today to speak for us. So without further ado, the reins are all yours, Jason.
Great. Thanks, Amanda. Can you see my screen okay now?
Yes, looks good to me. If anyone, just as a note, if anyone has any problems during this presentation, please drop a note in the chat. I will be watching there.
Great. Well, thanks everybody for joining me today. You might think it's an odd time of year to hear a ghost story, but as some of you may know, the Christmas season is not unusual to share ghost stories, and I hope you enjoy this one. So my presentation is The Devil's Cabinet, the Eddy Family of Spirit Mediums. The Eddy family was most well known in the late 1870s down in the Chittenden, Vermont area. And for those of you who don't know, Chittenden, the town, is not to be confused with the county, is about 6 or 7 miles north of Rutland. And we're going to learn all about them today. I hope you enjoy it. All right. So one piece of a newspaper article that I collected early on in my research, and I've been researching the Eddies for over a decade, well over a decade. And one of my favorite little clips was from an early article about an investigation that was done in 1874 by Colonel Henry Steele Olcott. And you're going to learn a little bit more about him today. But this little piece, there's one fun piece of it, and it says it was a story as marvelous as any to be found in history. And we'll see if you agree by the end of the tale. So to understand kind of the background of the Eddies, oftentimes I'll do a little bit more in my presentation on the history of spiritualism, but I don't go too far into that today because I wanted to make sure we have time for questions and answers at the end because there's usually a lot. But when we're talking about the Eddies, per the Eddies, they were related to an actual witch that was tried during the Salem witch trials, and not just one was accused, but an actual witch, they say. And we don't know if this is true, of course, because for a couple of reasons. One, we don't have any proof that they were tied to anyone connected with the Salem witch trials as of yet. I've tried hard to make that connection, and someday maybe we will, you know, through genealogy, find that connection, but we're not there yet. But they told the tale that they were related to a real witch who escaped from the trials with the help of friends and family, escaped to Scotland, and then returned to the U.S. later and had the descendants. And it's said that in the family lineage, it was actually the female side of the family that had the gifts of mediumship. Now, the Eddy family we're going to talk about today, there were 11 children and the two parents, Zephaniah and Julia. And oftentimes when you hear people talk about the Eddy family, they refer to them as the Eddy brothers. And when they say that, they're usually referring to William H. Eddy and Horatio G. Eddy. But I also like to point out, they really, all of them throughout their time performed different exhibitions and seances or circles, as they were called also, except for the firstborn child, John Wesley Eddy. It's said that he did not have the gifts that the other his siblings had, but we're going to focus a lot today on William, Horatio, and Mary, but each of them really has their own story. Now, again, the gift of mediumship, or the ability to speak to mediums, it's said came from their mother, Julia Combs, or sometimes called McCombs Eddy. And these are really the only two sketches and a painting on the right that we have of Julia. And she was said to have some of the gifts you would come to expect from a medium, speaking to the dead, getting omens, you know, being able to tell the future, different things like that. And she tried to hide these gifts from her husband initially when they got married, from Zephaniah. He was a very religious man, it's said, and really felt that all of these types of gifts were the work of the devil. But after the birth of the firstborn, John Wesley Eddy, who again was said not to have these gifts, once the second child was born, it was harder and harder for Julia to hide these things from Zephaniah. And initially he tried to, pray that these gifts would go away. You know, he might look out the window and see his son speaking to dark figures out in the field, and he would ask them about it, and the figures had disappeared by the time he asked them about it. But, you know, they would kind of deny what was happening because they knew from the mother that the father would not approve of their gifts. So he tried to pray this issue away, and when that didn't work, he got together with some neighbors, and the story goes that they tried to essentially torture the children. They would go into trances, and the father would try to break them from their trance by putting, say, a hot coal in their hand or pour scalding water down their back to break them from the trance. But eventually, you know, when this failed, the father resorted to selling the children out, actually, to a traveling showman. So goes the legend. And the children supposedly made little to no money traveling throughout the United States in the 1860s. And most of the money either went to him or to the traveling showman. Some of the interesting things that would happen, supposedly they were uneducated children. The children, they went to school, but strange things happened in the schoolroom, such as, you know, rulers and books flying in the air, and they were kicked out of school, so they had very little education. Another fun tale from their younger days, and it's a good example of sort of an omen of things to come. One night, in the middle of the night, they heard a carriage coming towards the house, and they went out to see what it was. And it was a carriage, a phantom carriage. They could see through it in the snow. And they ran inside to get a lamp. And when they came out and lit the lamp and looked, you know, the carriage just kind of faded away, and they could see no tracks in the snow or anything. And the mother and the children knew this was probably a sign of something to come, either good or bad. And in this case, it said this was an omen of their grandmother, Lydia's, death. And she died just a few months later, they say. Now, the grandmother, although she had died, was said to reappear in the boys' room at her spinning wheel, and she was dressed just as she had been dressed in life. And, you know, initially she came to them as a what you would think of a ghost, you know, they could see right through her. But eventually she developed a very physical form, and the children were scared at first, but eventually grew used to her presence and were eventually comforted by her presence. And this is the type of thing that would happen a lot to the Eddies when they were younger, some different phenomenon, as you might say. Now, here we have a sketch of William Eddy, and on the right we have William and his spirit guide, Santum, and we'll talk a little bit more about the spirit guide later. there's not many photos that exist of the family, and those that are out there are kept pretty tight by descendants of the Eddy family today. I've seen some, but I've had people request that I not share them. So I can only share with you what I have that you see today. Here we have a picture of Horatio Eddy. Now the picture on the left, it was in came from a 1976 Burlington Free Press newspaper. And it said that that's Horatio Eddy, although I actually suspect that was the older brother, John Wesley Eddy, but uncertain at this time. But the sketch on the right is definitely of Horatio. And again, when people talk about the Eddy brothers, they're talking about William in the last picture and Horatio here. And then very significant also to the family is Mary Eddy Huntoon. And Mary Eddy is not to be confused with Mary Baker Eddy. Now, one of the things that I like a lot about this picture, and this, of course, is from Mary's older years, but if you look closely, you can see ropes. She's tied up in ropes, and we'll talk a little bit about that in just a minute. Now, the Eddy brothers, when they grew older, again, the father sold them out to a traveling showman, and they traveled, they say, all through the United States, mostly in the Northeast, a little bit into Canada. It's also said that they performed for President Lincoln and Queen Victoria. We don't have any evidence that supports that right now, but they definitely traveled a lot in the Northeastern states, mostly. And at the top of the screen, you see the exhibition years, 1856 to 1871. Now, that's based on what they say in their story of when they started exhibiting. They supposedly exhibited for 14 or 15 years, but I haven't really found much evidence of them exhibiting prior to about 1862 or 1863 at the earliest. Definitely by 1864, they became well-known throughout the United States. Now, in this picture, you can see they're in a box. You can see William on the left and Mary on the right and Horatio outside the box. And this was their cabinet or spirit cabinet, as it was sometimes called. Now, that particular device became very famous from the Davenport brothers who preceded the Eddies on this type of exhibition. But they, what would happen is, so they travel all through the United States visiting town halls, things like that, and they would charge 25 cents or 50 cents for people to come see their exhibition. And what it was, would they'd be tied up by committee members from the audience. They would go inside this box. Instruments might be placed in the middle of the box, and then the doors would be closed before the audience. And then no sooner would these doors be closed, and again, they're inside, they're tied up securely, and then those instruments would be played immediately. And there would be an aperture at the top of the center door where a face might appear or a hand might appear. They initially described it as a human electricity or a human magnetism, and then later as spirits were causing these manifestations. And they became very well known for this, and again, traveled all through throughout the United States. And it wouldn't always be, like in this picture, William and Mary in the box. Sometimes it would be the two brothers, or it might be Horatio and Mary. They kind of mixed it up and, again, traveled all over. And at different times, they actually split up, and William and Mary did their own thing, and Horatio did his own thing with other mediums. But I won't go too far into that. Now, one of the interesting things I found about the Eddies, one of the earliest mentions in the newspapers, was a meteoric stone fell on the farm of Zephaniah Eddy. Zephaniah was the father, on Friday the 13th, December of 1861. And this was the type of thing, you know, they might view as an omen. And we'll talk about that. So again, that was December 13th, 1861. And what's fun about this article is it didn't just appear in the Vermont newspapers. It appeared all throughout New England. And this was really prior to the Eddies getting a name for themselves doing these exhibitions, the Spirit Cabinet exhibitions. One of the things that would happen to them when they did these exhibitions was, they would form committees from the audience, and people would come up. They'd usually look for people who knew how to tie a knot. So it could be sailors or carpenters, and also people who were respected by the town, and to make sure there was no sort of, foolery, trickery happening. They often also did exhibitions in private exhibitions at people's homes. And you can see in these sketches some of the ways they were tied up, because, you know, when they did these exhibitions, people either thought they were the real thing, they were really conjuring up spirits and speaking to spirits, or they thought there was some sort of illusion to all this, or they thought it was real, but it was the work of the devil. So people would try to tie them in pretty ingenious ways to try to show, you know, that maybe they were doing it through trickery. And these are just some examples of some of the ways that they were subjected to. The one on the right in this image is kind of fun. He's got a dowel in his mouth, and that's to prevent ventriloquism, because sometimes voices would be heard from inside the spirit cabinet, and they wanted to prove that, you know, it was possibly one of the mediums using ventriloquism and changing their voice to be the voice of the spirit. This is kind of a fun note here. November 1867, this is from Horatio Eddy's diary. He said that in this diary entry that their mother's heart would have bled had she known what they had gone through in Canastota. And it doesn't really give us a lot more detail, but what was said was that oftentimes they were, you know, almost, they were tied up almost to the point of torture. You know, some of the people in the town were so convinced that they were fraudulent and were just tricksters or illusionists or magicians, you might say, that they would tie them, you know, very, very tightly, and to the point where they often had marks on their wrists and ankles and things like that from ropes. And it said that they, you know, some of these towns, again, thought they were the work of the devil, or they thought they were fakes. So they really faced a lot of problems in some of the towns. Waltham, Massachusetts, they had to fly for their lives. Lynn, Massachusetts, Horatio ended up with a scar on his forehead from where a brick hit him and a broken finger. South Danvers, Massachusetts, they were fired upon by hidden assassins. William had the scar of a bullet in his ankle, and Marion one in her arm. Horatio had a stab wound in his leg. Oftentimes, it's said that the cabinet would be destroyed at the end of the performance or exhibition by angry mobs. And in one instance in West Cleveland, Ohio, it's said that they narrowly escaped being tarred and feathered. And, you know, sometimes we think of being tarred and feathered as, you know, you might think of it as a comical thing that you might see in a Bugs Bunny cartoon or something. But as most of you probably know, it was very painful and could even be fatal. And in this case, they managed to escape it, but it nearly happened. They were ridden on a rail outside of town, so they were tied to a rail and taken by two men or more and basically dumped at the edge of town and told never to come back again. And again, that's because either they were viewed as, you know, doing the work of the devil with the black arts, or they were thought to be fraudulent. And they were often arrested, by the way, in different towns for doing jugglery without a license. But I won't go too deep into that today. Some other interesting things that would happen. In 1861, Zephaniah, they were at the home, and Zephaniah was in the space on this diagram in the house labeled A. This was like the sitting room or the family room. And they were in this room, and the father wasn't feeling well and decided he would go to bed. So he went over to his bedroom in B on the map here on the diagram, and his bed labeled C. And he got into bed, and the family could all see him get up, go into that other room. But the next thing they knew, they heard something behind them in the doorway marked D on this diagram, and it was Zephaniah. And they looked over, but Zephaniah was still in bed. So somehow a doppelganger had materialized behind them. And then when they looked back again, the doppelganger was gone. So these are the type of just strange things that the Eddies, you know, were known for. Sometimes when they were very young, they would be lifted up in the air from their rooms and allegedly levitated out the window and dropped on a mountain somewhere 3 miles away. Very strange things. Now, March 18, 1862, Francis Eddy, one of their brothers, died. He was in the Civil War and came down with a bad cold on a march and came home to die. And there's interesting stories with each of their deaths, and I don't have time to go into all of them, but I will say one of the legends about the Eddies is that they often would write down in the family Bible the day and time of their death before they died. and supposedly these things came true. Another brother, James, died the next month, April 18, 1862. And then the father died on Sunday, July 13, 1862. Now, I want to go back for a second to talk about that omen, the meteoric stone falling on the farm on Friday the 13th, 1861. So within 7 months, three members of the family had died. So perhaps that was an omen. It's also said when the Eddies were out doing these exhibitions that they did, I mentioned earlier that they had done a, had performed for President Lincoln. And where that comes from was from William Eddy's obituary. It said that they had performed for President Lincoln and Queen Victoria. And again, there's no evidence of this. We do know that President Lincoln and his wife were inviting spiritualists to come to the White House, and sometimes would travel outside the White House to spiritualist homes for seances or circles. But again, there's no proof that the Eddies did meet with the president, but I'm still digging. Another story that's told during their exhibition days was at the Lyceum Hall in Buffalo, New York. Horatio was levitated 26 evenings in succession in Buffalo in the Lyceum Hall, and he was bound to a chair, and he was hung by the back of the chair to a chandelier hook in the ceiling, and then lowered again to his former place on the floor. And again, this was all done through invisible agency or spirits. March 29th, 1871, Miranda Eddy died. Now, Miranda, I'll share a little bit about her story. It's said that she was actually the most powerful medium of all the 11 children, but there's really not a lot of information out there about her other than that story of her being the most powerful medium. But there is one piece. When she died, like all the other deaths in the family, she had written down the day and time that she would die in the family Bible. Now, there was a woman, she was sick and her family was tending to her. And there was a woman in the neighborhood who would sometimes help out with funeral type services where she would lay out the bodies in people's homes and, you know, dress them and that type of thing after they had died. And for some reason, Miranda didn't like this woman and did not want her to touch her body after she died. And it's said that when she gave her last breath, Miranda reached up with her own hand after she had died and closed her own eyes with her own hand. March of 1872, the spirits tell the family that William Eddy is now going to be, now that Miranda has died, William Eddy is going to be developed as the greatest medium of the age. And he must no longer sit for the instrument playing exhibitions as he had been doing for a number of years. He and Mary and Horatio, some of the other brothers and sisters may have participated in those, but those three really were doing the bulk of that. So they were gonna stop doing, the spirits told them to stop doing these exhibitions throughout the US and that they must go into the spirit cabinet alone and take no bells or instruments with them, and that now they would be able to fully physically materialize. So it wouldn't just be, you know, instruments floating in the air or sounds coming out of the cabinet. Now, physical bodied manifestations of spirits would appear. That's what the spirits told them. And in late 1872, Julia Eddy, the mother, she passed away. Now, again, Julia told the family when the day and time that she would die. And she also said that after she died, there would be an incident at her grave. When her body was being carried to the grave, something would happen. And I'll tell you what that is. So after she had died, two gentlemen were friends of her father. Initially, she wanted some of her spiritualist friends to carry her body in the casket to the gravesite, but they were unavailable. So she had to rely on some of her husband's Zephaniah's friends who could help out. And these two gentlemen, it said, were having some sort of legal dispute with each other. And they started arguing while they were carrying her body to the grave, and they ended up dropping the casket and it tumbled end over end. And this story supposedly is exactly how she had foretold it would be. So now the seances, and or circles as they were called also, they stopped doing these spirit cabinet exhibitions. Now they were going to start doing it at their home in Chittenden, Vermont. And this is really the piece that the Eddies were famous for. And we're going to talk a lot about what exactly that entailed. So January 1st, 1874, they had built this, well, prior to that, December 1873, the circle room was built in their house in Chittenden. And when I say circle room, the room was not round or a circle. It was circle as in seance. And it was open to the public on New Year's Day, 1874. The spirit of a sailor named George Dix made a lengthy dedicatory address. And he declared, among other things, that the apartment was to be used solely for spiritual seances, with the occasional exception of a quiet dance. And we're going to talk a lot about this. You're going to see the spirit room from all different perspectives. And one other note was that they did these seances or circles every night of the week except Sundays. Now, one other piece to their story that sometimes some of you may have heard of is Honto's Cave, which is also in Chittenden. It's very near the home up in the woods. Now, it's become kind of popular, although it really has a very, very small part in the story of the Eddies. It's not really a cave. It's two giant boulders that are just kind of leaning against each other. And what the brothers and the rest of the family would do is they would set up a platform down in the bottom area in the cave or between those stones, and people would come to visit to observe these circles or seances. You know, many people from the neighborhood all throughout Vermont and even outside of you know, New England, all throughout the United States, and some people from out of the country would come to visit the Eddies and see these materializations, these physical manifestations. But they didn't always do it at the house. Sometimes they would do it outdoors, and in this case, Honto's Cave. And what would happen was William, now said to be the greatest medium, he would be seated in that little space down under the rocks, and a shawl would be put up. He would be bound to a chair, and suddenly figures would materialize. Now, the cave, they say Honto's Cave, is named after a Native American 16-year-old spirit named Honto. That's where that gets its name from. And it wasn't always Native Americans that would appear. It would be departed loved ones, friends, family, sometimes politicians, deceased politicians. And of course, Honto would appear. That's what the cave was known for. Here's a picture that I took of Honto's Cave. So the sketch is very accurate in terms of what it looked like. Here's a sketch of Honto. And you'll see a little bit more about her in a minute, because she also appeared at the house very often. And then Asha Sprague, some of you who are familiar with Vermont history and Vermont spiritualism may have heard of her before. I believe the Vermont Historical Society published a book, I forget the author's name, but I forget the title, it's 7 years, something like that. But there's a whole book about her, and recommend you check that out. So she had died, and her spirit would also appear at the cave. Now, nearby, it's said that there was an Indian burial ground, and there was a grave there, and you can see the sketch here with, and it's said that the William's spirit guide, a Winnebago Indian chief named Santum, was allegedly buried there, and one of the brothers had carved the Christian cross on the stone, and that stone is actually still there. This is a picture that I took. And one other piece, sometimes they would, in addition to the cave and the grave of the Indian chief Santum, the brothers would sometimes set up shawls around, say, three trees in the middle of the woods. And they would, you know, no sooner would they set up these shawls, and they would do it in front of everyone, than the Native American spirits and other spirits would start to appear, you know, from within that space. They would step out from behind the shawl. And here's a sketch of what Santum, the Winnebago chief, looked like, a very tall Native American. Now, here's the real meat of the story. This is, you know, how the Eddies became most well-known was through Colonel Henry Steele Olcott. Now, Colonel Olcott, he had been in the Civil War. He wrote a lot of articles on different things from agriculture to other things. He was, one of his roles in the military was to look for fraud. Very respected man, very smart. He later became an attorney and still continued to write for different newspapers. And he had heard about the Eddies and how, you know, they could materialize these physical manifestations of spirits. He had read about it in a spiritualist newspaper called The Banner of Light. This was about July of 1874. And since he had all the connections with different newspapers, he spoke to the editor at the New York Sun and convinced the New York Sun to have him go to visit the Eddies for a week in September of 1874. And investigate and see, are they the real deal? Were they really manifesting physical spirits? So he came from New York City, took the train to Rutland, took a carriage up to Chittenden, and he wrote a letter to the newspaper. It was published in the New York Sun on September 9th, 1874. And right at the beginning of my presentation, I showed you that little clip of a newspaper article where it said it's the most marvelous story in the world or in history. That's where this comes from, was from this initial investigation by Colonel Olcott. Now, you know, he basically came away saying that he thought they were legitimate, that they were actually causing, you know, these physical spirits to come, you know, people's departed loved ones and friends. So it became such a sensation that a rival newspaper, the New York Daily Graphic, asked Colonel Olcott to go back to Chittenden and spend 12 weeks there and report his findings. So they wanted him to do a really thorough investigation, so much so that they allowed him to bring an illustrator with him named Alfred Kappus, who some of these sketches you see today are from Alfred Kappus that were published in the New York Daily Graphic. So the colonel went back for a second time, and this was Thursday, September 17, 1874. He arrived at the Eddy homestead, and this is this image here was about what he looked like in 1874. And you're going to see some different sketches I'm going to have here of the inside and outside of the house. I'm going to go through these pretty quickly to make sure we have enough time for questions and answers at the end. But the idea is to show you sort of the layout, because, you know, some people think, well, maybe these spirits were just, you know, Confederates in disguise, dressed as spirits. So the colonel investigated all this and had his illustrator do these sketches. So this is what the house looked like in about 1874. And in the back, the circle room was on the second floor in the back section of the house. And this is another angle here. And that circle room was kind of behind where those three trees are on the right. That's the back part of the house, the L, as they would call it. And here's the rear view up in the top part. You can see one little window on the left in the back here. That's the spirit room, and I'll show you what that looked like on the inside, but there's the circle room, and then there's the cabinet, which is basically like a closet now. It's a little different than what they did when they were touring. And up above it, you can see those two windows just below the chimney there. That was the attic area, or as they called it, the cock loft. And I'll show you what that looked like too. And then down underneath the circle room was the dining area, and we'll show you what that looked like as well. So here's the dining room directly below the circle room where they had these seances. So people would come from all over, and you couldn't just show up at the Eddy's door and say, I want to attend a seance. You had to write to them in advance, and the spirits would tell the Eddies whether or not someone could come. And they never charged for the seances now, the way they did it with the exhibitions out when they were traveling. Now it was, they only charged for to stay at the home. And the seances were just part of the package. And you have the kitchen area. You can see a sketch here with William doing some of the work. You know, he looks like maybe he's peeling potatoes or something. William was known to be more of an introvert, and interestingly enough, did a lot of the interior chores of the house. And this was a working farm, I might add. Here's the buttery, which was kind of in the back area. Again, this is all right below the seance or circle room. And the reason for all these sketches is to show that there were no trap doors that went up through the floor into that room. The colonel was very meticulous in his investigation. He went up in the attic or the cock loft above the circle room, found no evidence of trap doors, no evidence that anyone had been up there. It was very dusty. And then this is what the circle room looked like. You can see some benches set up where people come to observe the circles or seances. And then that area in the back, you can see the rail there. You can see on the right, there's a door. And that's this little closet that was now the spirit cabinet. And that's where William would go in and spirits would come out, physical spirits would come out of that space. And I'll show you what those look like as well. So they did three types of circles. They did what they called a light circle that was usually conducted by Horatio Eddy, and blankets and shawls would be put up. It was very well lit. I'll show you what that looked like in a minute. The dark circles, usually Horatio did these as well. Horatio would be bound to a chair. All the lights would be extinguished. American Indians would dance in the darkness. Strange noises would be heard, voices, furniture would be thrown about. I'll show you what that looked like. And then a materialization circle. That's what the Eddies were famous for. William Eddy would go into that cabinet or closet and physical spirits would come out. Now, the light circle looked a little bit like this. A shawl, and again, this was all done in front of the audience. A shawl would be put up in the back, and then Horatio would sit in front of the shawl, and they might have one or two people from the audience sitting next to him. And then no sooner would these shawls be set up, and they'd be holding hands, as you can see here, then instruments that had been placed on the table in the back would suddenly appear up above or be played, and you could see a hand sticking up above the shawl in the back. Now, what's significant about this one is this hand was missing a finger, and Horatio had all of his digits, so that couldn't have been Horatio's hand. And then sometimes a hand might come through the shawl and write down on a piece of slate a message from beyond. Now, Horatio's, sometimes a baby's hand would appear from behind the shawl, and it's important to note, again, Horatio's hands not only looked very different, they were adult hands, they were elongated fingers, he was a thin, tall man, and the wrists had scars from years of being tied up out on the road during their exhibitions. So that was the light circle. Then you have the dark circle. Typically, Horatio would be tied to a chair. There might be a table set up near him. Instruments would be placed on that table. The light would be extinguished and noises might be heard. Native Americans might be heard dancing in the darkness. And when the light would be lit back up, the table has been, you know, thrown about. Instruments would be thrown all over the floor. Now, one thing, you know, I do try to point out some possibilities here for skeptics. Certainly in this instance, Horatio was sitting very close to that table, and he potentially could have scooped out the leg of the table with his right foot and caused that table to flip over and all the instruments to fall. That doesn't explain how the instruments were played, of course, but that's just one possibility. I like to throw in these from time to time. Sometimes when I do this presentation for a live audience in person, I do some what they call seance illusions or magic and show you some different ways that a magician might do it. Now, this is, and so that was the dark seance. Then you have the light seance. I'm sorry, the materialization seance. This is what they were most well known for. So William, after the chores were done for the day, they would say, you know, it is time, and they would go upstairs to the circle room, and they actually did the materialization circle before the light and the dark circles, which I found interesting because to me that was, you know, really what people were there to see, and you'd think they would have saved the best for last, but that's not what the spirits dictated, apparently. So again, this is a working farm. They would work all day, and usually at the end of the day, after their guests had been fed, they would go upstairs at about 7:30 or 8 o'clock, and that's when these circles were done. So William would go into that closet or cabinet at the back of the circle room, and he would sit, and you can see the sketch here. It's a very small space. The colonel went into it, investigated it thoroughly, made sure there were no trap doors, any places where costumes could be hid. There was a window in there, which caused a little concern to the colonel, a little suspicion. So he wanted to make sure that, you know, maybe someone wasn't down below outside, maybe putting up a ladder and climbing in through the window. dressed as a spirit. So he made sure to put someone down there to guard outside to make sure no one was going up in there. In fact, the only reason they say that a window was there at all was initially there wasn't, but there was a hot July day when it was so hot that William passed out. So they had to put in some kind of window there. That's what the story says. Now here's a sketch or diagram looking from up above down into that circle room. Now, over on the right in that dark space, the black square, that's the chimney. And just below that, that's the circle, the spirit cabinet or closet where William would sit. Now, some of the skeptics point to, if you look at the upper line that goes diagonal to the back of the room, the distance, there was only one light during the materialization circle, and it was 29 feet, 6 inches from the doorway where these spirits would step out. So a lot of skeptics point to that and say, you know, and this is from people who were there at the time writing about it, besides Colonel Olcott, said that, you know, they didn't feel there was enough light to really see the faces and features of the spirits coming out. But other people swore that their own departed loved ones were really there, and that they could identify them visually, and in some cases through voice. They didn't always speak, but some did. Here's a sectional view of the cabinet. The colonel also made use of construction contractors, architects. He had a lot of people come and look at the house with him to make sure there was no trapdoors or any other way that people dressed as spirits were coming into that space. And this is what William would look like when he would go in there. He would go and sit in that chair and fall into a trance. And no sooner would, you know, the shawl be put over the door than spirits would start coming out. That looked very different from William, and I'll show you what a few of those looked like. They weren't always your departed loved ones, friends and family who died and were coming back through William's mediumship. Sometimes there were pirates, witches, and Native Americans, politicians. A popular spirit was the old Witch of the Mountain, and I'm going to go through these pretty quickly to make sure we have time here. Honto would appear. Sometimes she would make shawls magically materialize in front of the audience. And sometimes Honto might come out, and there would be a voice coming out from you know, William would supposedly still be sitting in the closet or cabinet, and different voices would be coming out. Honto never spoke, so sometimes the spirit guide or spirit control might say, Honto wants to smoke, and someone from the audience gave her a pipe and she smoked up on stage, up on the platform. Sometimes Honto would be very animated, and in this instance she draped her hair over the back of the rail and allowed Colonel Olcott to take a sample of her hair to send in for analysis to see if it really was Native American. And on a rare occasion, Honto even came around the side of the rail and from the platform and played on the organ. Now, it's said that she really didn't know how to play the organ at all. It was just more banging on the keys, but it was significant that she came around the other side of the rail. Now, some people point to the rail as, you know, why is there a need for a rail there? And the reason for that is, as you may recall, when the Eddies were doing their exhibitions out on the road throughout the United States, they were often attacked by the crowd. So they grew wise to that, and they built this rail in front to give them a little bit of protection. And it was also said that by the time they were done touring, they were packing, meaning carrying their own firearms or knives to be ready to defend themselves. Native American spirits would appear: Bright Star, Santum, Owanda. I'm going to go through these quickly. The sailor, George Dix. Usually he wouldn't be seen. It would be his voice that would be heard. Mother and child, middle people. And this is where it gets interesting. So you have William in the box. Now, if it was just William, say, in disguise, you know, how would he have been able to look like a woman or a baby or someone of Middle Eastern descent? Spirits of all different sizes, heights, different weights, and you'll see the colonel even brought in a scale and different. He put up a measuring stick next to the door so he could accurately record the different heights of these people. And Honto would step on the scale, and it would show as like 50 or 60 pounds. Then she'd step on it again, and it would be a different weight. So very interesting things happen. Sometimes people would come and would speak in different languages, and the spirits would you know, speak in their language. In that case, a German named Max Lenzberg came and the spirit spoke to him. It was his departed loved one. So how would the brothers who were uneducated have been able to learn all these languages? There was a woman who had been murdered in Williston, Vermont, who appeared and came out and spoke about the grisly details of her death. And running out of time here, but the mother of the Eddies appeared on October 2nd, 1874, and came out and spoke for 15 minutes. And I'm going to skip through some more here. There was even one instance where the colonel said, okay, I get that you can do these seances and upstairs, but let's do one downstairs. So he kind of tried to throw the Eddies off a little bit so they couldn't prepare. And they chose a room, and no sooner had they chosen this room than and put up the shawl, and William went behind the shawl, and a spirit of a woman and a baby came out. And then just kind of wrap it up here. There was a gentleman named Dr. Beard who arrived while the colonel was there, and he definitely believed that the Eddies were fraudulent, and he wrote a whole article about them. He felt that it was William dressed in disguise every time coming out and impersonating spirits. Madame Blavatsky, a Russian occultist or spiritualist, she came. While she was there, different spirits appeared, Kurdish warriors, so a lot of different costumes and things, people of different skin color, different languages. It would be hard for the Eddies to come up with all of these things. Now, when Madame Blavatsky was there, allegedly a family bodyguard who had deceased, he came forward and gave her medals that had been buried with her father. She gets a lot of attention in the story of the Eddies, but she was also just a very small part of it. And then just to wrap up the final few slides here, Colonel Olka, he stayed there 12 weeks. He wrote about his experiences to the New York Daily Graphic. It was published twice a week for several months. And he basically came away a believer that the Eddies really could cause physical manifestations of spirits to appear. He thought some of the things they did might have been tricks, but he felt the manifestations were real. He came back to Rutland in early December, Rutland, Vermont, and spoke about them in a lecture. And this final image here, this is what the house looks like today. Now, the original house actually was torn down in 1898. So what you see here was built shortly after that. But it's actually belongs to a ski club based out of New Jersey now, but the house is still there. And they say strange things still happen there. So that's it. I'm going to open it up for questions. I know I went through these last ones pretty quickly.
Thank you so much, Jason. That was, you've done quite a lot of research. It's terrific to see, and it looks like there's a lot more.
So much more to the story.
Yeah. We do have quite a few questions, but before we launch into those, I'm particularly struck by the number of times and the ways in which the Eddies appropriated different cultures to sort of quote unquote prove their true spiritual connection. It seems they leaned most heavily into appropriating Native American figures through their own interpretive lens, but you mentioned that they also were having spirits manifest from the Middle East and potentially Africa as well. Do you think this is sort of an attempt to convince Vermonters who may not have had any direct experience of Native American culture or African culture that they were the real deal? Did it lend a sort of sense of quote unquote exotic to the proceedings?
Yeah, I think that was something they were trying to give more credence to their abilities. But some people say the only reason that the spirits of the Kurdish warrior, that type of thing, or the African, those only appeared when Madame Blavatsky was there. It definitely was not uncommon for Native American spirits to appear at different seances, not just with the Eddies, but other spirit mediums of the time. So that was definitely a thing. There's a whole book about that. I think it's called A Specter of the Indian, I think, is the name of the book, which goes into detail about how it became kind of a common thing. Now, I mentioned how I like to throw out, possibilities. Now, let's say if the Eddies were fraudulent. Now, people say, well, where did they get all these costumes? How did they speak these different languages? Although unlikely that they learned all of these other languages, German and Russian, the story goes that they perform these exhibitions all throughout the world, and that they went through at least two of these traveling showmen who took them all throughout the world, and this was for 15 years. Is it possible they could have picked up other languages while they were out on the road? Maybe. Another little thing I want to throw out there to think about is the Eddies. It's said that they were uneducated, illiterate. They only had a few weeks of schooling because they were kicked out when they were young. But I want to point back to one thing I showed you, and that was the diary entry from Horatio Eddy. Now, if they were uneducated, illiterate, is it likely that he would have been maintaining a diary? I don't know.
Yeah, they certainly seem to have been master showmen of one type or another. So we'll go through some of our questions now. One of the questions is, it's hard to ignore that their traveling exhibitions were occurring during the Civil War. Did they travel anywhere where there were battle encampments or forts where they would put on a show for soldiers?
Nothing that I've seen in any of my research, and I've researched it very heavily. They primarily, as I mentioned, performed in the Northeast, a lot in New York, a lot in, of course, Vermont, some in New Hampshire. No evidence of performing in Maine yet, but definitely Rhode Island, Salem, Massachusetts, which I like to point to as another possibility. Now, they say they were descendants of real Salem witches, and I like to point out that they performed in Salem, and what a great place to craft a story like that, if they were fraudulent. But they performed in Pennsylvania, Ohio, and not too many places really outside of the Northeast.
Great.
And nothing, you know, no evidence that they performed like, you know, for some sort of encampment or something like that.
So it was more of a home front activity during the Civil War.
Yeah, but one interesting thing though, on the evening that President Lincoln was assassinated, they were to perform their second night in the Burlington Town Hall or City Hall. And I don't know if they actually did end up performing that night because of the events, you know, if it still happened. I don't see any evidence that they did, but they were scheduled to. It was their second night in Burlington.
Interesting. Another question, were the Eddies part of the organized spiritualist movement in Vermont, such as the Vermont Spiritualist Association, which got its beginnings in 1868 and had annual conventions through the 1880s?
There's not a lot of evidence that they were tied too closely to the Vermont Spiritualist Association. They did, however, often appear down at Lake Pleasant at the camp there in Massachusetts. I think it's Montague, Massachusetts. They definitely participated there. Now, at that time, and this was later 1870s where we find evidence of that. Now, by that point, there was a lot of infighting that was happening in the family between Mary and William, Horatio, and some of the rest. And so oftentimes when they were at Lake Pleasant, they weren't together. They would have their own separate tents or rooms, you know, for some of these, you know, cottages and things that were set up, and would often badmouth each other while they were there. But they definitely participated in those, but not too much evidence about the Vermont Spiritualist Association or even the Queen City Park Association. Just very, very little.
Yeah, we've
they
got
did
a
appear. Oh, sorry.
Sorry, we've got a confirmation that it was definitely Montague, Massachusetts. Lake Pleasant is one of the villages within the town of Montague. So someone from the chat who knows the area. Great. Continuing questions. One is, did any of the Eddy descendants ever take on the family seance business after William, Horatio, and Mary passed away? And sort of a continuing follow-on question, what were the Eddies like later in their life after the sort of the prime of the spiritualism movement? Did they sort of fade away? Pun not intended.
So the first part of the question, Horatio had no direct descendants. William only had one child who died very young. Mary had several descendants, as well as her younger brother, Daniel Webster Eddy, had many children. So those two really are the kind of the primary in terms of, you know, descendants that we see today. Now, William was actually the last of all of the siblings, all of the 11 children to die. And by the time he had died, that was 1932, it had pretty well faded out. And none of the descendants of Mary Eddy Huntoon or Daniel Webster Eddy had any involvement in the spiritualist movement that I have found. Now, I have talked to many modern day descendants of those two lines of Mary and Daniel Webster, and some of them do believe they have some kind of gift, and none of them claim to physically materialize spirits, but they do feel like there's something to it. And then what was the second part of the question again?
The second part was, what were the Eddies like later in life after their spiritualist prime? You mentioned that William passed away in 1932, and presumably he wasn't holding seances by that point.
So 1874 was their big year. That was most of the events I talked about today with Colonel Olcott and that investigation. But things really fell apart in 1875 and 1876. And the family, there was massive infighting. Mary mostly stayed in Chittenden and in Pittsford or Pittsfield. I always get the two mixed up. But she stayed very nearby in Chittenden. And Daniel Webster, he did a little bit of performing out on the road. And then William, at different times, he lived in New Jersey. He lived in Moravia, New York. Him and his sister Delia. Delia actually stayed in Moravia, New York. William ended up coming back to Chittenden. But they did continue to do private exhibitions, either at their home or at others' homes, for quite a while into the, you know, early 1900s, but beyond that, it got pretty quiet. Like Mary did more in the early 1900s. William had kind of faded out from doing much at that point. And then, yeah, in the early 1900s, they all started to die off, and yeah, it just kind of died with them.
And I should also add, you mentioned a little bit about descendants. We did have a descendant in attendance today who was adding some interesting things in the chat. We had some earlier questions in the chat about the house before you showed us the picture at the end, which, so you answered those questions ahead of time, but the descendant remembers the remembered the house in the family. So some additional questions. Were there ever any suspicions of magic lantern projections as a way that they accomplished these things?
No, I haven't heard of anyone bringing that up as a possibility. Most of the, you know, these physical manifestations, they would come right out on stage, and sometimes would touch people on occasion, but never anything like a magic lantern type of projection device.
Okay. Did the Eddy descendants? Sorry. Oh no, we've already answered that. If any of them held continued seances, sorry about that. How do you have any sense of how much money the Eddies made doing this? Were they extremely well off, just getting by, somewhere on that spectrum?
Well, there's not a ton of hard evidence on how much they made. Now, I know when they did their exhibitions, during the mid-1860s to early 1870s, they typically earned 25 to 50 cents for general admission, and for at these different town halls, and people would I think pay 75 cents to a dollar for reserved seats, and it's not really clear how much they actually made from that. And the legend says that the showman either made most of the money or the father made a piece of that, and that they didn't really get much. Now, having said that, once they got back to Chittenden and started doing the seances at their house, it's said that they did have a lot of money. Horatio in particular bought up lots and lots of property and was pretty generous with it. He helped out his brothers and sisters, even though there was a lot of infighting going on. He often would purchase pieces and transfer them off to different members of the family. So it's said that Horatio had a good deal. But by the end of William's life in 1932, he had developed dementia and was living as a ward of the state in a nearby, a gentleman named Charles Greeno was taking care of him at the end of his life, but didn't sound like he had a lot of money left. But Horatio definitely, I think, had a good deal. There was a time when William wasn't really doing much exhibitions and Horatio was still doing a lot. In the late 1860s, early 1870s. And Horatio, I've read accounts of where he got a lot of kind of exotic things, pets and things. When Horatio died, it's said that the house was so full of stuff, what we would today know as a hoarder, that they couldn't have the viewing of his body in the house. They had to have it on the porch because he had so much stuff.
Well, a lot of eccentricity in the family generally. The question is, how did the family seances or reputations end? I wonder if did any of them lose their reputation towards the end of the period, or do you think the fading of interest in the Eddy family was due to people believing them to be frauds? Do you think it was due to a fading of interest in spiritualism generally? Were they just not getting out and about as much?
Both. So during the 1860s, the Eddies, I mentioned at one point that they were arrested several times for fraud and for performing exhibitions without a jugglery license. That jugglery, for those of you who don't know, refers to entertainment. And there were several cases outside the Eddies where people were brought before federal court to prove. The most famous case, probably Charles J. Colchester, who had performed for President Lincoln. He was brought into court, and they tried to prove, it was expected to prove that he was a legitimate spirit medium, and there's a whole story behind that. But they were caught. It was said they were caught several times in the act of fraud during their spirit cabinet exhibitions. And I'll give you an example real quick. So they'd be tied up inside the box. There'd be instruments placed in the middle. The doors would be closed and the instruments would be played. Well, there was several instances where the Eddies, unbeknownst to them, someone from the committee in the audience would put lamp black, basically like an oil, a black oil on the instruments. So they do their routine, the instruments would be heard, the doors would be open, the Eddy brothers would still be tied up, but they had lamp black all over their hands. So that was evidence to the attendees that it had to be the Eddies who were somehow getting out of their bonds and playing the instruments. Now, later, there definitely was a wane in interest in spiritualism, and the Eddies in 1875, a damning letter came out, allegedly from one of the sisters. We don't know who, but it was anonymous. But it was allegedly one of the sisters that explained how the Eddies did their tricks in the house. And the story goes that there was a special staircase built next to the large chimney, and they came up through a trapdoor in the floor, and all of the spirits were actually friends and family of the Eddies dressed in different disguises. All we know is that right after that story came out, Horatio was adamant that that was completely not true, and he invited people to come investigate for themselves. But they had been sort of busted so many times over the years that, interest kind of waned. Now, you'd think people wouldn't have even been coming to their house by 1874 because they had been busted so many times in the 1860s as being what they said were frauds. But I think a lot of it has to do with just the nature of communication at that time. Obviously we didn't have the internet in the 1860s, so people couldn't, easily do research to see if they had ever been caught in the act of fraud prior. So somehow they managed to maintain a pretty solid reputation, at least until 1874. And then, things got really, really ugly. There's a lot more to the story.
It sounds like, we look forward to the book. One more really interesting question from an attendee. Spiritualism in the United States seemed to grow in popularity around the death and devastation of the Civil War. Do you think we might see an increased interest or resurgence now during the pandemic, during another difficult time?
I do. I think there's the spiritualism, or at least the belief in being able to speak to a departed loved one. It's always been there. And, all you have to do is turn on, certain channels that carry, psychic mediums that, it continues to this day. Absolutely. People will continue to have hope that they can speak to their loved ones from the other side. And, even the ones you see out there today, Thomas John is one of the really, really popular ones. And some of the different ones behind the TV shows, Medium and Ghost Whisperer, those mediums have allegedly been detected in pieces of fraud. There's a group that is very actively right now, the past couple of years, they perform these basically sting operations. They go in dressed in disguise under an assumed name and get into the audience of these mediums and make up a story essentially, or wait to see what the medium tells them about their family. And what they've been finding in some of these instances is the medium, the alleged psychic medium, has done research on Facebook about the person. And so these people going in disguise had set up fake Facebook accounts, you know, with departed loved ones' information that weren't real, and the medium would be feeding them that information. So they were able to prove they were frauds, and it's happening all the time. But you know, it doesn't, the word doesn't really get out there. So people continue to believe, and I'm not saying that there aren't legitimate spirit mediums. I spoke with one myself who I can't explain. She was pretty good.
Thank you. So I want to add just briefly to that comment. There's a superb book about the impact of the Civil War on a sort of Americans' perceptions of death and suffering. It's called This Republic of Suffering by Drew Gilpin Faust. It's a really excellent, it's, as you can imagine from the subject and the title, fairly depressing, but extremely thoughtful, very good piece of history for anyone who wants to think a little bit more about that context.
There's a documentary out there on that as well, with the same title. Yep. Based on that book.
I did not. So I would recommend that as well. I've read the original book and can recommend that. Another question. What was the reason that the original house was demolished in 1898?
In the article that I have that describes it, it was from the New York Sun, and it was October of 1898, I believe. And it didn't say the house was in disrepair, but all it said, it was a long article, but it was mostly about the history of the family. And it said it was just being torn down to be replaced with a more modern building was the gist of it. But it didn't go into a lot of detail on the whys.
Great. It looks like there's just another note. The attendee, someone notes there was an article on spiritualism in Brattleboro published in the Vermont History, our the Vermont Historical Society's journal, called Spiritualism in Brattleboro, 1886 to 1889, One Man's Contact with the Afterlife Through Letters. And I would note that we do, in 2018, that article should be digitized and available on the Vermont Historical Society's website. So go to vermonthistory.org and look for the listing for the Vermont History Journal, and you will see past issues of that journal. It's volume 86, number 1, winter, spring 2018. So at the other end of the state perspective on spiritualism down in Brattleboro. And I also have a request to put the information about the Faust book in the chat, which I will do momentarily. But I will give everyone just another moment or two to put in any last questions they might have, and I'll ask our speaker one question to sort of carry us through and see if anyone else wants to ask a question, which is to say, obviously the Eddies are gathering fame throughout New England at this time. Do you see any other mediums from Vermont? You mentioned Ox's Sprague a little bit, but do you see any others rivaling their popularity, or would you put them as probably the most well-known group of mediums at this time?
I would say they were definitely the most well-known. There were a few other pockets throughout Vermont that were having, you know, spiritualist conventions, mostly tied to the Vermont Spiritualist Association. But in terms of popularity, there was nobody bigger and more talked about than the Eddies at that time. There were definitely some places in Woodstock and Reading and some other places that were very active, but just they didn't, you know, there was no one who was coming out with this ability to physically materialize. That was the big sell, I think, for the Eddies.
Great. John Dunville mentions in the chat, Sleeping Lucy, Lucy Ainsworth, I believe her last name is another medium in Vermont. Another question, do you know Alex George, who's a philosophy professor at Amherst College? He does magic tricks that he explains are psychological, and he's also studied spiritualism.
No, I haven't heard of Alex.
Yeah, that's a good one for you. So we have one question I think is a great one to go out on. I heard mention of a book, which was that I mentioned, mostly that I'm hoping you're writing a book. Can you tell us what other ways you're pursuing this research and planning on sharing it going forward?
Sure. Well, how I first got associated with the story was I have been involved in local filmmaking, and I thought, wow, this would make an interesting film. So I wrote a screenplay called The Devil's Cabinet. And but I wanted it to be very authentic. I wanted it to be authentic to Vermont, and I wanted it to be authentic to the Eddy family story. So that's when I started doing all this research. And then I was invited, when I went down to the Chittenden Historical Society to see what they had for research, and most of what they had, I already had. But then when they saw what I had for material I had dug up, it was stuff they had never seen. So they asked me to do a presentation down there. This was several years ago now, in 2014, I think. And so this sort of launched me into doing presentations about the Eddy family, which wasn't something I had ever set out to do, but I just loved to tell this story. So people started asking me about a book. And of course, I was mostly focused on the screenplay and the research for the screenplay. But then I realized I had so much material. I mean, I have thousands and thousands, literally, of articles about the Eddies from newspapers, spiritualist publications, in addition to land records, tax records, military records, education records. Yes, one of the Eddies did, at least one, went on to higher education and actually became a teacher. But that's, I'll save that one for the book. So yeah, I'm compiling all of the research that I've done. And the first book was going to come out this year, but there's still a few more pieces I really need to get to tie it all together. So, and with COVID, I just wasn't able to get those pieces. So it'll be released in 2021. The first book is called The Devil's Cabinet. And I say the first book because that's going to be the kind of the touring years when they were out on the road, because there's a lot just to that component that's never been published before. And then the second book will be called Spirit Vale, which is what the area in Chittenden, Vermont was known as at that time. In 1874 in particular, they started to become known as Spirit Vale. And that period, that book will focus on the Eddies doing their seances at the house. So there'll be at least two books coming out, possibly even a third, because I've collected a lot of stories from people who've had experiences that are either Eddy descendants or people who've had experience in the ski lodge, the house that stands today. So I kind of thought it might be fun to share stories to, you know, show that the story does go on. So there's definitely more to come, and there's so much more to the story, so much more. There's attempted murder, there's a suicide attempt, there's morphine overdose, kidnapping. There's a lot more to the Eddy story.
Well, we look forward to hearing it. One last question, I think a perfect way to go out. Can you tell us if you have a website where people can go and see more of your research?
Well, I'm glad that you asked that question, which made me think of one other thing. For those of you who are ever interested in stopping at the house, so it is just a note, it is private property, but you know, the ski lodge who owns it, you know, they understand there's interest in it. And you know, I don't think they have a problem with people going into the driveway to quickly take a picture from outside. The area near there where Honto's Cave is and Santum's Grave, those are on two other people's properties. And I do, they've had problems with people vandalizing and trespassing up there. And they don't really like people going up in there without permission. So if you ever think you want to go to Honto's Cave or Santum's Grave, definitely make sure to get permission first. I'm sorry, what was the question again?
Your website.
The website, thank you. So yes, I do have a website, jasonsmiley.com, which I don't update it too much. I also have a Facebook group. If you just type in Eddy Brothers Spirit Mediums, you'll find the Facebook group. I tend to update that more because I add all of the events that I do. I usually do several presentations throughout the year, especially during October, as you would imagine is a popular time for a ghost story. But yeah, I will be updating both the Facebook group and the website. You know, as soon as the book's available, it'll be on Amazon, and hopefully I'll be able to get it out in different stores and locally and beyond.
Well, we definitely look forward to that. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us today to learn more about the Eddy family and to learn that there is still so much more to tell. Thank you, Jason, for speaking for us today. Make sure you check out vermonthistory.org for upcoming programming, including lots of remote and digital programming in 2021. And as I said, this program has been recorded and will be available on YouTube going forward. And thank you, everyone, and have a great rest of your snow day.
Thank you, everyone.